This plastic water bottle is about to go on an adventure. And not to a landfill, although hundreds of billions like it certainly end up there every year. And not to a recycling plant, which would be better. No, this bottle gets caught in a gust of wind and makes its way to a nearby river. From there, it's off to see the world. It has a ticket to the Pacific Ocean and eventually the 1.6 million square kilometer Great Pacific Garbage Patch. And unfortunately for all of us, the adventure doesn't end there. It's gonna break into tiny pieces and wind up in places even the most seasoned travelers rarely go. Are your bags packed? Because we're gonna tag along with this plastic bottle on its entire trip. We'll see the bottom of the ocean and the North Pole. We can't promise it will be pretty, but understanding this journey is the first step in stopping other plastics from taking the same disturbing path. This episode was made in partnership with Wild Hope. Wild Hope is a series of short, free documentaries right here on YouTube that bring you stories about scientists and changemakers who are restoring our wild places and sparking new hope for the future of our planet's biodiversity. Worldwide, as many as 34 billion plastic bottles end up in the ocean each year. That's 4 bottles for every person on Earth, and most of them come from countries that have a lot of coastline, like the US. So our water bottle has plenty of company as it floats down a river in the American West and into the North Pacific. Rivers are one of the main ways that plastic gets from the land into the sea. As much as 2.7 million tons of plastic makes this trip every year. And once our bottle plastic does reach the sea, ocean currents take it for quite a ride. The Earth's prevailing winds, together with the force from the rotation of the planet, create a number of large circular currents called gyres. These pull floating plastics toward their centers, and in the North Pacific, this creates the infamous Great Pacific Garbage Patch. Our water bottle's journey can take a few years, but once it reaches the patch, it joins as many as 3.6 trillion other pieces of plastic. Everything from fishing equipment to buckets and crates to other food and drink packages. And despite that being an unbelievably big number, there is weirdly less plastic floating on the surface of the ocean than scientists expect there to be. We've been churning out plastics since the 1950s, yet less than 1% of the plastic that has ever entered the ocean is floating on the surface today. So where did the other 99% go? Well, the vast majority of it appears to sink and degrade. Take our bottle, for example. The only reason it's still bobbing along on the surface is that it still has its cap. That cap is made of a durable plastic called high-density polyethylene, or HDPE. This will float on its own and will stick around in the garbage patch for a long time. But the bottle itself is made of polyethylene terephthalate, or PET. This is a lot less durable, and crucially, it doesn't float very well. So once the cap separates, the two part ways forever, as the bottle takes on a little water and sinks down into the abyss. We'll get to its fate in a minute. But back on the surface, the cap keeps bobbing away. While plastic takes an incredibly long time to completely decompose, it does fragment and break apart. And out in the open ocean, there are a ton of forces helping that process along. UV radiation and oxidation slowly degrade the chemical bonds holding the plastic together, which makes it easier for wind, waves, and grinding against other trash to break it up into smaller pieces. This is how macroplastics gradually turn into microplastics, pieces that are less than 5 millimeters. And that's a big part of how 99% of the plastic that has ever entered the ocean can seemingly vanish. They're not gone forever. The plastic just gets too small to see with the naked eye. Microplastics are very hard to track, but thanks to the diligent work of scientists, we've begun to figure out that they go, well, everywhere. Seriously, it would almost be easier to list the places we haven't found microplastics. So our story of a single plastic water bottle now splits into the stories of thousands of microplastic pieces spreading out throughout the world's oceans. One small floating piece gets gobbled up by a hungry albatross, and other bits are eaten by fish and sea turtles. As you might expect, these pieces aren't great for the animals' digestive systems. Seabirds are especially vulnerable because they don't tend to regurgitate things they can't digest. Ingested plastic makes animals feel more full, and so they eat less. A 1995 study found the more plastic birds ingested, the less they weighed. And a 2023 study documented a new disease in seabirds called plasticosis. This is when plastic pieces damage and scar the inside of a bird's digestive system. As the remaining bits of the cap break up into smaller and smaller pieces, algae and plankton build up on them, weighing them down and causing them to sink. In surveys, is scientists have observed more little pieces of plastic below garbage patches than elsewhere in the oceans. They refer to this as plastic fallout. Eventually, many of these join the rest of the bottle on the seafloor. Researchers estimate that the plastic sitting on the ocean floor could weigh as much as 11 million metric tons. That's at least 10 times as much plastic as is floating on the surface. PET, which our bottle is made of, is thought to stay relatively intact for around 15 years in the ocean, but it too will fragment eventually. Invertebrates living on the seafloor, like worms or sea cucumbers, can ingest those microplastic fragments, contaminating a deep-sea ecosystem we still barely understand. And some pieces of our bottle end up traveling even farther. They get caught by ocean currents flowing northwards and make it all the way to the Arctic. There, they freeze into sea ice, only to be released back out and continue the journey a few years later. A gray whale swallows another microplastic fragment, but it doesn't stay put in the whale's digestive tract. A 2023 study found that microplastics can migrate between cells or through a whale's circulatory system and end up lodged in its blubber. And microplastics can be toxic. The plastic itself can include toxins, but we also need to worry about everything that piece of plastic picked up on its long journey. Smaller plastic pieces have comparatively more surface area than bigger ones, and most plastics are hydrophobic, meaning they repel water. But that surface can attract other hydrophobic substances. This includes toxic chemicals like PCBs. So microplastics act as little collectors of these chemicals. This means PCBs can be concentrated a million times more on microplastics than in the surrounding water. When animals ingest microplastics, they get a huge dose of all these chemicals, and yeah, animals includes us humans. A final microplastic fragment from our bottle washes towards shore where it flows through a shellfish farm. It gets ingested by an oyster, which is eventually harvested, shucked, and slurped down by an enthusiastic foodie. Fish, shellfish, and drinking water are the main ways that microplastics end up in us. They've been found in human lungs, blood, intestines, and more. Most of what we know about the effects of microplastics on our health comes from laboratory experiments. These have shown microplastics can be toxic to cells and cause DNA damage. Experiments on human organoids, which are lab-grown tissue samples, have shown potential toxic effects to airways, intestines, the liver, and brain. We're just beginning to see results from the first studies looking at microplastics in actual living humans. A 2024 study found that people who had microplastics in their arteries had a higher chance of stroke, heart attack, and death. Now, I know this sounds like a lot of doom and gloom, but we are making progress on stopping plastic from making this journey. And at every step of our water bottle's trip, there are people working on ways to give this story a happier ending. It all starts with waste management. That means making sure bottles either get recycled or get disposed of in a sealed landfill so they don't escape into the environment in the first place. And we kind of have to say this every time, but the best solution to plastic waste is to create less of it to begin with. What if we just replaced 1 in 10 plastic bottle purchases in coastal countries with a refillable bottle? Even that small fraction could prevent as many as 7.6 billion plastic bottles every year from going on a similar journey as ours did. Still, we need to tackle the problems that we're facing today. That means doing our best to clean up the mess that we've created. And there are promising efforts to clean up the plastic that does slip through the cracks. Since the width of rivers is a lot smaller than the vast expanse of the ocean, it would have been a lot easier to catch our bottle when it was still in the river. People have tried everything from floating booms to cleanup boats to simply collecting plastics by hand along the shoreline. And these have had a lot of success. In the early 2020s, an organization called the Ocean Cleanup deployed floating barriers across drainage gullies in Jamaica, Guatemala, and elsewhere. These catch and hold floating plastics until they can be scooped up by a small barge. In Baltimore, two trash wheels have scooped 750,000 plastic bottles like ours out of the harbor so far. And even once our bottle made it to the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, it wasn't beyond reach. The Ocean Cleanup has designed a net specifically for this purpose that can be towed between two ships to capture floating plastic. They've demonstrated that we can clean up ocean garbage patches directly, but that doesn't mean it's going to be easy. A 2019 study estimated that achieving a significant reduction worldwide would require nearly 2,000 more ocean cleanup-sized projects. So there's no easy way to rid the planet of microplastics, but cleaning up rivers, beaches, and even the Great Pacific Garbage Patch represents an opportunity. This is a chance for us to rescue all of that plastic before it fragments into microplastics, slips through our grasp, and ends up in the world worst possible places. This video was inspired by the episode from Wild Hope, The Great Ocean Cleanup. Watch that episode now and many more from Wild Hope right here on YouTube or follow at Wild Hope TV on Instagram to discover countless more stories of changemakers working to restore biodiversity around the globe. Change is closer than you think.